إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله تركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك ولا ينتظم في سلكها إلا سالك. اللهم صلي وسلم وأنعم وأكرم وبارك على حبيبنا وشفيعنا وقرة عيوننا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك عليه في الأولين, اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك عليه في الآخرين, اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك عليه في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. يقول عز من قائل: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. اللهم اجعلنا منهم يا رب العالمين. أوصي نفسي وإياكم بتقوى الله وبلزوم طاعته أناء الليل وأطراف النهار على الوجه الذي يرضيه عنا. In the name of Allah, the gracious, the merciful, to him we belong and to him we shall return. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his infinite grace and boundless mercy to send an abundance of prayers and peace upon our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with us on this blessed day of Jumu'ah, to elevate our ranks, to forgive our sins and our shortcomings and our weaknesses, and to make firm for us the light of Yawmul Jumu'ah, the light that is in store for the people of Suratul Kahf. May Allah help us to always fulfill the sunnah of reciting Suratul Kahf on every Friday with the hope that bi-idhnihi wa bi-fadlihi, by His permission and His grace, that we are granted the affirmed light from one Friday to the next. For certainly, my dear brothers and sisters, we are all in need of the light of Allah to shine for us brightly in this world that at times can be so confusing and challenging. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this blessed day of Jumu'ah to protect our brothers and sisters across the world, from east to west, from Africa to Asia, to Europe, to the Caucasus, to the Balkans, to the subcontinent and beyond. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of our brothers and sisters, grant them relief and ease and comfort and wellness, and grant them all of those who are facing difficulties and hardships, tyranny and oppression, to grant them wellness and refuge and solace. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. Brothers and sisters, our mother Aisha, the beloved wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she tells us in a narration that kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yasumu hatta naqula la yuftir wa yuftir hatta naqul la yasum. That we would see, she would say, we would see the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasting until we would say he won't break his fast. And then we would see him not fasting until we would say that he won't fast. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he worshipped in a myriad of ways. And at times he would elongate the periods of his fast, and at times he would elongate, seemingly, as our mother Aisha teaches us, the moments where he would not fast. And then she says, ما رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم استكمل صيام شهر قط إلا رمضان. And I have not seen the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم complete the fast of an entire month except for the month of Ramadan. وما رأيته, as she says, وَمَا رَأَيْتُهُ أَكْثَرَ وَمَا رَأَيْتُهُ فِي شَهْرٍ أَكْثَرَ مِنْهُ صِيَامًا إِلَّا شَعْبَانٍ. And I have not seen him, outside of course the month of Ramadan, fast so much as he would fast in the month of Sha'ban. And so what we glean from this, brothers and sisters, is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was keen on fulfilling particular types of acts of worship and designating specific acts of worship for the month of Sha'ban. And in particular, it was the fast. Now perhaps some of the wisdoms behind that is that Sha'ban precedes Ramadan, and this is a great way to prepare oneself spiritually as well as physically for the worship that is required in the month of Ramadan, and that is predominantly the fast alongside the regular worships that we do. But also, the fast is, there's a secret behind why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose the fast. And he tells us in another hadith, narrated by Anas ibn Malik in the Sunan of Imam al-Nasa'i, where Anas ibn Malik, who was the helper and the khadim of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asks him, Ya Rasulullah, lam araka tasumu shahran min ash-shuhuri kama tasumu min sha'ban, aw kama qal, that I have not seen you fast any other month, of course, except for Ramadan, the way that you choose to fast in the month of Sha'ban. And so our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he gives the reason. And he says, ذَلِكَ شَهْرٌ يَغْفُلُ عَنْهُ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ, that this month of Sha'ban is a month that many people neglect. Many people are not mindful of this month. ذَلِكَ شَهْرٌ يَغْفُلُ عَنْهُ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ بَيْنَ رَجَبْ وَرَمَضَانِ. This month of Sha'ban is a month that most people neglect, and it resides between the month of Rajab and the month of Ramadan. Now, the month of Rajab, as we spoke about last month, is Shahrullah, the sacred month, along with the other three sacred months. It is an identifiably unique month, standalone, Rajabul Fard. And so perhaps many people will be aware, cognizant of the fact that Rajab is a sacred month. And no doubt that all of us, without saying, we know what the month of Ramadan is. فَهُوَ غَنِيٌ عَنِ التَّعْرِيفِ. You know, we don't really need to explain too much why Ramadan is so virtuous. And we become obsessed thinking about the month of Ramadan. And certainly when this month of Sha'ban that we are currently in comes along, it just kind of goes unnoticed and we become hyper-focused on the potential of the month of Ramadan. And so for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is indicating this. He's saying that people will come to be neglectful during the month of Sha'ban. So the first reason he gives for taking time and designating a particular act of worship in the month of Sha'ban, it is because the majority of people are neglectful. I want you to keep that in mind and we'll reflect upon it momentarily. The second reason the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives is he says, هُوَ شَهْرٌ, it is a month, تُرْفَعُ الْأَعْمَالُ فِيهِ إِلَى رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. This is a month where the actions of the ibad are raised to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are raised to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأُحِبُّ أَنْ يُرْفَعَ عَمَلِي وَأَنَا صَائِمٌ. And I love that my actions are raised and elevated while I am in a state of fast. Brothers and sisters, this hadith narrated by Anas ibn Malik should tell us a lot about the nature of ibadah and the intentionality that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us when it comes to particular acts of worship. First and foremost, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he takes the time to fast in the month of Sha'ban because of the distinct fact that he knows the majority of people are not thoughtful, they're not intentional, they're not taking it upon them to designate acts of worship because everyone is geared up for Ramadan. Whereas the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us that some of the most precious moments ma'allah that you and I can commit ourselves to ibadah is when other people we know are not mindful. That's why from the beautiful adhkar and ibadat that should be made is the dhikr that is made when you go into the marketplace. The dhikr that is full of la ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, lahul mulk wa lahul hamd, yuhyi wa yumit wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir, and others. These types of adhkar, they are the dhikr that is made in the marketplace. Why? Because when you're in the marketplace, if you go to the mall, you go to the shopping center, we all know that the majority of people are certainly not thinking about ibadah. They're not thinking about dhikr. So the Prophet is teaching us, in those moments when you know full well people are not aware, perhaps of Allah, or proactively thinking of Allah, then you make yourself stick out in ibadah. And for us, on a day-to-day basis, perhaps one of the most precious times for that reality to be is the night vigil. It is being ma'allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the night. وَبِالْ أَسْحَارِ هُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. Those who are awake in those waqtu sahar, before fajr, that period before fajr, awakened to be present ma'allah, not to be sleeping perhaps in utter, you know, at times forgetfulness, but to be awake, thinking, I know that most people are sleeping right now, but I am awake, not watching TV, not reading the news, not playing video games, not hanging out with my friends into the morning, just hanging out in some club or some area, but rather I am sitting ma'allah. And I'm doing it in the prophetic spirit of making myself really stick out in front of Allah. And that is the intentionality that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam brought into ibadah. And this should come to inform how we even think about the concept of taqwa. The concept of taqwa as being conscious of Allah, being aware of Him, being mindful of Allah. The Prophet is teaching us there are times when it perhaps is easier when you're in the masjid for Salatul Jumu'ah, right? And inshallah you're not on your phones checking your Facebook or your Twitter, because that could invalidate your Jumu'ah. Many of my brothers and sisters have come to me after many salawat saying, Shaykh, please advise people. I find them on their phone, text messaging, playing, doing, checking their feeds. All of this, brothers and sisters, is from that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has taught us. Take us away from Salatul Jumu'ah. So your phones are put away and you're sitting in the masjid and you're listening to a khutbah. You're about to pray salah. So perhaps, yes, it is more accessible that we remember Allah in these moments. But certainly, when we think about the way in which we live our lives, there are times when we just naturally don't think about Allah. So perhaps the next time I'm at work and all of my coworkers are just hustling and bustling, running after their next assignment or duty or responsibility, you kind of take a pause and you look around yourself and you say, I want Allah to see me in this moment in a state of remembrance. So maybe, yes, I don't have to stop and pray except for the obligatory prayers, but I can make dhikr. I can say La ilaha illallah. I can say Muhammadun Rasulullah. I can say La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. I can say Astaghfirullah, because I know that perhaps when I'm at work, I'm at school, I'm walking through the streets, there are so many things that I am exposed to that I see that are creating a type of, you know, rust on my heart. Because that's what sins do. They darken the heart. It's a nukta. Nuktatun sawda. And so perhaps I intend in that moment, I want Allah to see that, yes, even though I'm in a sea of all sorts of realities, I myself am mindful and I'm making dhikr and istighfar and tawbah. So the first profound lesson from this hadith of Anas ibn Malik is that لَبُدَّ أَن نَتَحَرَّى أَوْقَاتْ الْغَفْلَةِ لِنَخُصُّهُ بِالْعِبَادَةِ. That we identify the times when people are neglectful and we designate specific ibadat for those times. And all of us know those times for ourselves. The second point that the Prophet ﷺ teaches us in this hadith is that he tells us that in the month of Sha'ban, the a'mal, the actions of the ibad, are raised to him. They are raised to him. And what he wants that when his actions are being raised, he is in a state of siyam. And the reason why siyam is so special, as we spoke extensively this past Sunday in the Artensive on the inner dimensions of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a hadith Qudsi, "As-sawmu li wa ana ajzi bih," that fasting is mine, and I am the one who rewards for it. Because out of all of the ibadat, the sawm, the fast, is the one that requires the most sincerity, if you will. Because no one knows if you're really fasting except Allah. So the Prophet ﷺ is teaching us that this ibadah of the fast is so special and so unique that Allah does not designate for it a reward by a specific amount. Because he says that ibadat can range from 10 hasanat to 700 hasanat. Except for fast, it belongs to Allah and He will reward as He sees fit. Meaning that don't worry about it, just fast and I will take care of you. That's why in other ahadith, those who fast, a fast lillah, for the sake of Allah, then Allah will place 70 kharif, 70 seasons between them and Jahannam. You will be completely distanced from the hellfire when you commit yourself to one day of a sincere fast ma'Allah. And so certainly you see that from the ibadah that the Prophet ﷺ is constantly engaged in, certainly not just in the month of Ramadan, but outside of the month of Ramadan, and he's very keen on maintaining, is the fast. And specifically in this month of Sha'ban, because as he said, يُرْفَعُ فِيهِ الْأَعْمَالِ, that the actions are lifted, and I want Allah to see me in a state of siyam. But brothers and sisters, it's important to note that the actions are not just lifted in the month of Sha'ban. The actions of the year are lifted in the month of Sha'ban, are raised in the month of Sha'ban. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designates that the angels lift or raise the actions not just yearly, but also weekly. And that is every Thursday. The actions of the believers are raised to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also Thursday is from the days where we are recommended to fast on the guidance of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But it's not just weekly that our actions are raised, but they are also raised daily. The Prophet ﷺ tells us, يَتَعَاقَبُونَ فِيكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ, that amongst you there are angels that come and go in the morning and the evening, and in specific at the time of Fajr and the time of Asr. This is where the shift change of the angels happen. One set of angels come at the month at the time of Fajr, they stay until Asr, and then another set of angels come and they replace, they change shifts with the angels preceding them, and those stay until the Fajr and vice versa, and continuously in that state. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the angels, how did you find my ibad at the time of Fajr? We found them yusalloon, we found them praying, Ya Allah. How did you find them at Salatul Asr? We found them praying, Ya Allah. And that makes Allah very happy. That to see that the times in which our ibadat, our actions are raised to Allah, are in the times connected to ibadah, whether in the form of siyam or in the form of salah. And so the second very important lesson that we glean from this is that we are cognizant and aware of the times when our actions are being lifted, and we commit ourselves to those time periods to be a little bit more intentional, present and aware. That I am keen on praying Salatul Fajr, ideally in jama'ah, ideally collectively with the community. I am keen on praying Salatul Asr together with the community. But if not, certainly I am praying those salawat on time. And I am thoughtful of the fact that the angels are shifting ranks. And I want my deeds to be raised. So we should never ever find ourselves ideally in a state where we oversleep from Salatul Fajr. Where we are not amongst those who the angels testify on their behalf that they witness them in a state of ibadah. Or that Salatul Asr comes midday and really it's a nuisance or a burden for me because I'm at work and I'm busy, and so I just kind of push it off into some time in the night when I may be free. Rather, I am very keen on carving out for myself a few minutes to ensure that I pray Asr, Salatul Asr, on time, before even the makruh time, which is when the sun becomes orange. That I'm keen on praying Salatul Asr on time, so that the angels are there witnessing my ibadah and they're lifting it while I'm in that state. So brothers and sisters, these are two very critical lessons that Allah, the Prophet ﷺ, teaches us about ibadah and about the logic of ibadah that we should be thoughtful about. And so from those ibadat, as I've mentioned, is that the month of Sha'ban, it should be a time where we fast, where we read Quran, where we become disciplined in our salah. We are extra thoughtful about this month being special because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself, his qalb, his heart, ta'allaqat bihadha shahr. His heart was attached to this month, and so I'm going to pay this month a bit more attention. Yes, there are only 2+ weeks or maybe 2 weeks from, we are only 2 weeks away from Ramadan. But I'm going to spend these next 2 weeks giving special attention to the month of Sha'ban. And I can certainly do that with the intention of being prepared for the month of Ramadan. One of our pious predecessors, he says that when the month of Sha'ban would come in, كَانَ يُغْلِقْ his hanut, he would close his shop. وَيَلْتَزِمْ الصِّيَامُ وَالْقُرْآنِ He would close up his shop in the beginning of Sha'ban, and he would stick to fast and the recitation of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us tawfiq to be cognizant to worship in this month. The second issue with regards to the month of Sha'ban that I want us to think about is the midpoint of the month of Sha'ban, known as Laylat al-Nisf min Sha'ban. Laylat al-Nisf min Sha'ban. And this night, it conjures up for many people all sorts of emotions and feelings. Because unfortunately, like so many other points of ikhtilaf in our ummah, we become very polemical, very dogmatic, very aggressive, very absolute, without actually taking the time to hear what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said about this night. And what the ulama have taught us throughout the centuries about this night. Yes, brothers and sisters, this is a night, there are a hadith that are sahih about this night. There are a hadith that are hasan, sound, good about this night. And there are a hadith that are da'if about this night. And there are a hadith that are da'if jiddan about this night. And perhaps there are a hadith that are mawdu'ah about this night. There is a cacophony of a hadith about the night of the middle of Sha'ban. However, there are so many ahadith in total, sahih, hasan, da'if, and other, about this night, to the extent that so many of our ulama, of the likes of Sheikh Mubarak Furi, in his explanation of sahih al-Tirmidhi, his book is called Tuhfatul Ahwadhi, Sharh Sahih al-Tirmidhi. He says, because of the sheer volume of the ahadith that talk about the middle point of Sha'ban, the 15th of Sha'ban, the night of the 15th of Sha'ban, then certainly there is a unique quality about that night, just by the sheer volume of all forms of ahadith. And the same was said by Ibn al-Qayyim. And the same was said by Ibn Hajar al-Haythami and many others. And so I am not interested in getting into the debate, into the senseless debating, the very shahwani debate, as I've spoken about in the past when we talked about the Mawlid or other types of, you know, points of khilaf. It is about the spirit that we should seek to embody in those moments. At the end of the day, everyone who says La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, their ultimate goal must be the attainment of Allah's pleasure. And yes, there is even a khilaf on the way in which you should spend these nights. Certainly, Imam Malik, for example, would not celebrate the night of the 15th of the Sha'ban. But others from the scholars of the Shafi'iyah and others did. That's it. Move on. We don't need all this tension. But let me just share with you the ahadith that are categorically sahih to get away from all of the potential confusion. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, إن الله ليطلع في ليلة النصف من شعبان فيغفر لجميع خلقه إلا لمشرك أو مشاحن. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He peers out on His creation in the middle point, the 15th or the night of the 15th of Sha'ban, and He forgives the sins of His creation except two categories of people. And pay very close attention. And this hadith is sahih. Number one, mushrik. Those who associate partners ma Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may Allah protect us from both forms of shirk. Ash-shirkul jari wa shirkul khafi. Because there is shirk that is obvious shirk, that someone may take an idol and worship it alongside of Allah or another ilah. But there is subtle shirk. There is the times when I may take even my TV or my phone or my shahwa. أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَاهُ. Those who take, Allah says, you not see those who take as their base desires their ilah. So we seek refuge in Allah from the different forms of shirk, because certainly we don't want to be excluded from receiving the forgiveness that is in store for the people who are intentionally present in this night of Sha'ban. And the second category of people who are excluded from Allah's forgiveness is the mushahin, the one who is fighting with someone else, the one who is disputing with someone else. And I know all of us, we may have people in our lives that we find ourselves hating, disliking, having a problem with. There is a shuhna, there is almost a charge, a negative charge that I have towards someone. This night, which by the way is tonight, Laylatul Nisf min Sha'ban is tonight, because tomorrow is the 15th of Sha'ban. Tonight should be a night where I reconsider how I feel about people, how I think about my brothers and sisters, how I think about my relatives. This is not to say that you or I may not have a genuine grievance with someone else, that someone took my rights, someone stole from me, someone harmed me, someone did something. And there's a haqq that I may deserve. There's a right that I may deserve. But we have to distinguish between a number of things. Number one, am I truly justified in how I'm thinking or feeling about that person? Because maybe it's just an assumption. It's something from my imagination or my desire or from the qeel and the qal, something that I may have heard. My family member called me and said, did you hear that someone said? And then therefore, I hate this person. Why? Because no, someone told me. And I get into that space where then I am a mushahin without any justification. And perhaps that puts me in a position where I am excluded from the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet is teaching us a very important point when it comes to the nature of ibadah. Is that we think of ibadah just simply as when I make wudu and I stand up and I go like this. Or if I fast or I do my hajj. Yes, that is one form of ibadah. But what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us is that there are dimensions to ibadah. There is a haqiqah to ibadah. And ibadah just does not exist in the ritual form. But ibadah is from the matters of the heart. Ibadah is from the question of mu'amala, how I deal with people, how I treat people. And yes, what the Prophet is saying is that we can be deprived. We can be deprived of Allah's forgiveness because I am unjustly or I am wrongly in dispute with someone else. I can be deprived of Allah's forgiveness. See, it's not just about shirk. Because the Prophet says, Al-Mushrik wal-Mushahin. Both get deprived. And so number one, I have to think, am I justified? Do I have proof? Do I have dalil? Do I have something that really in front of Allah I can say, Ya Allah, this is why I have a problem in my heart. But Allah doesn't want you to even stop there. Although that's the first, at least, condition. The second is that we distinguish between the haqq that may need to be fulfilled and how I feel in my heart towards my Muslim brother or my sister or my relative. We have to learn to distinguish between maybe you can forgive, you don't necessarily have to forget. Meaning that if someone stole from me $1 million, I may in my heart have the capacity, the spiritual capacity to say, I forgive, but I still need to resolve the question of the $1 million. Right? And that's where the huquq of the ibad come into play. That's where qada, that's where you have adjudication. Where you have hakamun min ahlihi wa hakamun min ahliha. That you may have a dispute between a husband and a wife. But certainly we don't want to have shuhna, hatred for one another. Because that hatred, what it leads to is destruction, pain, trauma. We hurt ourselves and we hurt each other so much because of unbridled, aggressive, uncontrolled anger and hatred. So I may need to reconcile. I need to bring people and parties and third parties, people from my side and people from their side, and we can come to a point of reconciliation to resolve the particular details. But certainly that should not what govern the state of my qalb. Because at the end of the day, what you and I, on the day of judgment, will look back to this dunya and say, why was I so obtuse? Why was I so naive? Why was I so simplistic? Why was I so self-indulgent? Why didn't I just forgive with my qalb? Look at my hal now. I could have had so much forgiveness, but I neglected it just because of my ego. Just because I didn't want to let it up. And what's even worse, brothers and sisters, is when you and I have an opportunity to have sulh, to rectify the condition between myself and someone else, and I don't take that opportunity out of ego, out of arrogance. That's even darker. That's even darker when someone is trying to create sulh and bring hearts together between a husband and a wife, between community members, family members, and people in society. But I say no because I just don't want to. May Allah protect us from the evils of ourselves. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam on multiple ahadith with regards to the night, all of these ahadith are sahiha with regards to the night, the 15th night of Sha'ban. Whether it is in Allah la yattali'u ala al-khalq, Allah looks at the khalq, or in Allah la yanzil, Allah descends in a manner that is befitting to Him, and He forgives the sins more than that are on the hairs on the ghanam, on the sheep of the tribe of kelb, meaning that if there are billions and billions and billions of hairs on all of their sheep, Allah forgives more sins than that. And Allah on this night, إن الله لا يغفر للمستغفرين ويرحم المسترحمين. Allah forgives those who seek forgiveness, and Allah has mercy upon those who seek mercy. And Allah يؤخر أهل الحقد كما هم. Subhanallah. May Allah protect us. And Allah delays and just pushes forth the people of hiqd, the people of hatred, as they are. So tonight, you and I can either be of the category who Allah will forgive بِإِذْنِهِ وَبِفَضْلِهِ by His permission and His grace. Because we come with a sincere, intentional heart of forgiveness. And musamaha, al-afw al-safh. And I'm cleansing myself of any potential shirk. Or I can be someone who says, even if it's the night of the 15th, even if it's Ramadan, even if it's Laylat Sabu Ashreen, even if it's Laylatul Qadr, I'm not going to stop to do what I do. I'm not going to stop feeling the way I feel. Then that is juhud. And may Allah protect us from that state. Because that is a hard heart that has become diseased. And may Allah protect all of us from having hearts that are diseased, that are hard, not knowing how to let go. Because the Prophet is saying, وَيُؤَخِّرْ أَهْلَ الْحِقْدِ كَمَا هُمْ. He will delay and elongate and push forth the people of hatred as they are. I can't even imagine, may Allah forgive me and forgive all of my brothers and sisters, that we are ever people who come on the Day of Judgment and I am defined as a person of hiqd, a person of hatred. And the hadith in this regard, with regards to the night of 15th, continue all about the same thread, about mu'amala, about how we treat one another. That's why also from the people who are not granted forgiveness on the night of the 15th of Sha'ban, is the person who treats his or her parents poorly. Al-aq li walidayh. Prophet ﷺ says, they will be deprived. Al-aq li walidayh. And many other categories. And all of these categories, subhanallah, they have to do with the same thing. How we treat each other. How we treat each other. So may Allah allow us and help us and enlighten us to cleanse our hearts and to learn to deal with one another bil husna, with excellence and beauty. May He forgive all of our weaknesses and our shortcomings and how we may have dealt with one another, with our family members, with our friends, with our community members, with our co-workers, with our classmates, with our friends at school, with my friends, if you're young children at recess, if maybe you treated some of your friends and you bullied them and you made fun of them. May Allah help us to cleanse our hearts from those states with the intention that bi-idhnillahi ta'ala Allah will grant us access to endless forgiveness. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. So brothers and sisters, what can be certainly agreed upon by the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, regardless of where you stand, is that this night, which is tonight, requires at the very least some presence of mind, some intentionality. Even if you are not amongst those who agree, or if we are not amongst those who agree that this night should be tuhya in some way. Even if that's the case, that's fine. There is a genuine disagreement on that. But certainly, as many and all the ulama have said, that the 15th is from the middle months, the middle days of the month, 13th, 14th, 15th. And so we can fast it from that perspective, that we are trying to fulfill the fast that is found in the middle of the month. And also fasting it as a day from the days of Sha'ban. Even if you don't do takhsis, all of that is fine, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. But don't get caught up in the weeds of this. Let us all have our hearts and minds present. At the very least, even if we sit for a moment, hunayatan ma'allah, we raise our hands and we ask Allah to forgive us. And we do that every night until bi-idhnillahi ta'ala we are entering into the state of the most beautiful, profound, possible states of the believer, and that is the month of Ramadan. Allahumma barik lana fi sha'ban wa balighna Ramadan. Oh Allah, bless us in this month of Sha'ban. Elevate us in this month of Sha'ban. Forgive our sins in this month of Sha'ban. And balighna Ramadan. O Allah, allow us to be amongst those who will worship you in the month of Ramadan. Receive the forgiveness of the month of Ramadan. Receive the mercy of the month of Ramadan. Receive the increase of the month of Ramadan. And receive the itq of the month of Ramadan. Receive the saving from the hellfire of the month of Ramadan. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsani wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun wa ladhikrullahi akbar wallahu ya'lamu ma tasna'un aqimis salat.